On this next leg of the test way, the path leads from Mottisfont to Stockbridge, passing through a broad chalky plain, and you walk along lush meadowlands on your way towards Stockbridge. Crossing the river near Oakley Farm, you come to something called the Oakley Oak, now protected by the National Trust. It was once hollow inside, and they say that in stormy weather, farmers used to take shelter inside it, and indeed, once a cow got inside and actually calved. It was a great local focal point and a kind of assembly area. All sorts of people came here, school outings, children, clambering all over it and inside it. It's now grown up inside, so it's no longer hollow. Actually, it's all rather overgrown, and the poor old tree is a bit, nowadays, a bit isolated. In fact, to and from the tree nowadays isn't quite as easy as it perhaps was then. I hate nettles, don't you? At this point, the path makes for the white cliffs of Lower Brook, parts of which are still worked for chalk. It's quiet and peaceful here, but this wasn't always so, since the Test Valley Railway used to run through here on its route between Andover and Redbridge. The track and sleepers have been removed and the bed grassed in, and it's this old railway route which the Testway now follows. Walking along this stretch can be a bit boring. Natural pathways seem to meander without reason, and around each bend there may be a surprise in store. But not here. Though I've been told that Hampshire County Council are encouraging it to wind about a bit. Eventually the path, as any path that follows the route of an old railway must do, arrives at a station. Horsebridge Station was axed along with this railway in the 1960s. Unlike the track, the station was not removed. It was built in 1865 and remains a small fragment of railway history. Horsebridge Station in its heyday, with what looks like a station master and five porters. Try and find one these days. And the train's late. I have the feeling that Fran and I could be waiting for rather a long time. Living at Horsebridge Station now is Val Charrington and her family, who came here recently.
Well, we moved in last November, but we've had the property for a year previous to that, so that we were able to do all the work. It was absolutely, totally derelict. It looked as if nobody could ever live here. You couldn't walk down the track here for brambles, thistles, nettles, broken down sheds, not a pane of glass. All the windows were boarded up. We had to replace all the window frames, the doors, the floorboards were all up. So you couldn't even walk through the building. And round the back, by the back door, was a sign which said, "This property is dangerous, keep out."
Right. But it looks lovely. It looks lovely now, but do you ever sometimes think, gosh, we did take on rather a lot?
No.
I have to ask, did you get it because you are a railway nut, a railway enthusiast?
No, we didn't. I saw the advert in the local paper, Horsebridge Station, and I knew Horsebridge as a child because I used to cycle out to see an aged aunt who lived behind the pub just up the road. And I remember walking along the track when the trains were still running,
right,
picking primroses and things like that. It was So I knew it very well for years ago, so...
And what, just the idea appealed to you?
Of living here, basically. Mm. And it wasn't until we actually took it on that my interest in the restoration started.
Right.
And I had to delve into all sorts of archives and find out what colour paint to paint it and how to go about it generally.
Well, I notice, of course, you've not only got a railway station, but you've got a railway carriage as well.
Well, apparently most people, when they look at a railway station, say, a swimming pool in between the tracks.
Oh.
And I say, well, how can you get a carriage through water? So I thought, if you've got a station, you need to have a carriage. So I got in touch with British Rail on their tender list, and I had a look around various carriages, and this particular one was in Bournemouth. It was a London and South Western and built in 1921. And I thought this was most appropriate for this particular line.
And also, of course, at the end of the platform, a signal box.
Yes, that came later. I felt every station should have a signal box, and ours had disappeared long ago, and I wasn't able to track down where it was. So there again, British Rail came in. The one I chose was at Yalding, and it was being demolished that following Saturday, so I had to make a very quick decision.
Well, you've achieved an enormous amount when one sees the original photographs. What to you is the nicest thing about living in a former railway station?
Oh, my goodness. I suppose it's the potential here. There's always something else to add to it and something else to collect. And people who are railway enthusiasts keep coming round to talk to me. I get signal people, I get carriage people. As long as we don't run out of steam, I think we'll... keep going.
Having taken tea and very welcome, I then took a diversion from the testway to Bossington. The test is not just one big river. It's continually splitting into smaller tributaries. And very pretty too. The valley is about a mile wide here, and the slow-moving river winds through meadowlands that provide plenty of lush grass for the grazing cattle. Near one of the streams, working in a shed, not out of place in Hardy's Woodlanders, I found Jeff Allen. After leaving school, Jeff worked in an insurance office and hated it. He became instead a river keeper, a job he loved, but after 10 years was made redundant. So he determined to make a living from his hobby, furniture making. Surrounded by clouds of cobwebs spun by companionable spiders and warmed by a homemade stove, Jeff works away contentedly. But he still remembers the early struggle to make a living.
One of the biggest mistakes I made was that the first few tables I built them from what is known as air-dried timber. It was oak that had been actually drying in a barn for 30 years. So I thought, great, this is wonderful oak, must be dry. And of course it would have been dry if it hadn't gone into a centrally heated environment. As soon as you put timber into central heating, although it's been seasoned 30 years, it would start to move again. And I had three or four tables come back to me with great splits, warped. So I was really knocked back at that stage.
Yes, I mean, that must have been really awful, your first work coming back falling apart.
That's right, because I'd spent hours and hours making these tables, and I was so thrilled because they looked so splendid at the time.
Right. How did you overcome this? How did you get it right?
Well, eventually I sort of realised you had to use kiln-dried timber, which is timber that's really dried down to the moisture content that you find in a centrally heated home.
Is there anything else you learnt in that first year?
One thing that I very quickly learnt was the fact that I couldn't stay to just using hand tools, because on the very large tables that I was producing, I used to hand plane the tops, and honestly, I used to go home on my knees. It was such hard work. So I thought to myself, I'll have to get some degree of machinery just to do the basic preparation work. And then, of course, I finish it off by hand.
Right.
But that stopped an awful lot of hard work.
I mean, was it originally that you wanted to be a purist, that you wanted to do everything by hand?
No, it's just purely a question of economics. I couldn't afford the machinery when I was made redundant. So it's a question I had to do everything by hand. And then gradually I got the odd machine. And yes, it stopped an awful lot of the heartache involved. I prefer large refractory tables, something that has a visual impact. And thinking back to the days when I used to go around stately homes, I used to look at these old period tables and think of all the happenings that have occurred round a dining table, the good times and the bad times. So I'd like to think in 100, 200 years' time, someone will look at my table and think, well, I wonder what's happened around that great big table.
Yes, because I suppose if you had to choose a piece of furniture around which things happen, it's the table where people gather, where people eat.
That's right. Yes, tables can tell so many stories.
Since making furniture, what's been your proudest moment?
I think that must be that a short while ago I was asked to make an exact copy of a 12th century bench that you can find in Winchester Cathedral. The Hampshire County Council were making an exact replica of a medieval garden behind the Great Hall of Winchester. And however, I made this bench, it was a magnificent bench, and the Queen Mother came along and she opened up the garden and she came along and had a chat with me and sat on my bench and complimented me. So yes, that was a red letter day in my life.
Jeff Allen, a man who successfully turned a hobby into a living and keeps a few large spiders warm and contented. Fran and I are back on the route of the old railway line on our way to Stockbridge. Nature, they say, abhors a straight line, and if you didn't know about the former Test Valley Railway, you'd guess that the hand of man had played a part here somehow. Into meadowland south of Stockbridge. This is common land with grazing rights held by the burgesses of the borough of Stockbridge. Although the common was vested in the National Trust in 1946, the ancient rights are still prorogued each year. Fran was keen to have a bathe.
Fran?
Me? Just happy to have a sit down. Where does she get all that energy?
Come on, friend. Stockbridge. Come on.
In Stockbridge, the town and the main street are virtually one and the same thing. Long and narrow. There's no depth to the place at all. Despite its location on the main roads between London and Salisbury and Winchester and Salisbury, Stockbridge remains as close to an unspoilt country town as you'll find, and well worth a visit. Seven streams make up the Test at this point, and the town is crisscrossed by water. Little runnels flow between the houses, alongside and under the main street, providing waterways for arguably the best-fed, most indulged, and noisiest ducks and swans in all Hampshire. And years interesting. A house with a B&B sign in Welsh to attract Welsh sheep drovers of old on their way south. It reads, "Seasonal hay, tasty pastures, good beer, comfortable beds." All right, boyo? Further down the street, a wonderful noddy petrol station, parts of which remind one of a Louisiana paddle steamer. But as a result of recent safety bylaws, if the license to sell petrol here ever lapsed, they'd never be able to renew it. They'd have to shut. As has happened at this garage across the road. It's now, despite its name, a furniture shop. Speaking of which, if there's one thing you soon notice about Stockbridge, it's the number of antique shops. In one such, I found the genuine article, a real-life Lord. Lord Douglas Gordon.
Lord Douglas, why are there so many antique shops?
I think, basically, because this is a very central area. We're close to Winchester, equidistant between Winchester and Salisbury. Lyndhurst, Southampton are all within easy distance. And a lot of people come down from London. They can do the round and then be back in time for a drink in the evening.
Right.
That's really, I think, the main reason. It's a very central area and a good place to have antiques in.
Of course, there are places, bigger places, like Burford in Oxfordshire and Broadway in the Cotswolds, which really have become one huge antique shop. I mean, do you think there's a danger of that happening to Stockbridge?
No, I don't. I don't think planning permission would be given for a large number of shops. I think there are enough here already to satisfy demand. I think probably that the demand for shops, antique shops now, is probably diminishing rather than increasing. I think the market has reached the top.
Above Stockbridge, the good, well-drained downland and wide-open spaces for combine harvesters make it ideal for the cultivation of hay and cereals. But this gentle scene was different in the Second World War, for this was the site of an airfield. Here, Spitfires made in Southampton were safe from enemy bombers. Ferry pilots would wait in temporary huts for orders to deliver the aircraft to airfields throughout the UK. No sign of that episode remains. But in the distance, there's still evidence of a history much, much older. The Danebury Ring. Danebury is an ancient earthwork and marks an Iron Age settlement of 2,000 to 2,500 years ago. Here would have been a hill fort surrounded by fields of corn and barley and a few animals. Grain and wool would have been stored here in exchange for manufactured and other goods obtained from outside or made in the compound. It's thought the settlement, supporting 300 people, thrived for some 500 years, ending suddenly at about 100 BC. Nobody knows why, but it was a fate shared by other hill forts in southern England at this time. Quite a bit later, Danebury became famous for horse racing. These horses are in training at a nearby stables, but in the 18th and 19th centuries, there was an established race course on Danebury Down, and there was racing here for well over 100 years. In 1850, for example, there were 8 races on the day's race card. From stables at Danebury came 3 winners of the Derby, 4 winners of the Oaks, 4 winners of the 2,000 Guineas, and 1 winner of the St. Ledger. At Danebury Racecourse was erected in 1831 the very first grandstand in the country. Amongst other grand visitors, Edward VII and Lily Langtry. And when digging was done to make this exercise track, endless champagne bottles discarded by the carousing punters were dug up. And the remains of the 1831 grandstand are still there today. The racing has long gone at the turn of the century, killed off by easier access to Newmarket and Ascot. But horses remain, used now only for hacking and kept at the stables once owned by Stockbridge's most celebrated jockey and later trainer, Tom Cannon. In the 19th century, the Cannon family was indisputably Stockbridge's most famous. Tom Cannon, known as the Master, won the Derby, the St. Ledger, the Oaks several times, and the 2,000 Guineas on 4 occasions. Tom Cannon's grave nestles in the little churchyard at Stockbridge. This man, described at the time as one of the most elegant, judicious, and cool horsemen that has worn colours, who, as a judge of pace and timer of finish, has had few equals, and who gained not only the applause, but the respect of the turf world. Also in the little graveyard, a reminder of the First World War and of the flying training carried out on the downs above Stockbridge by the Royal Flying Corps, shortly to be reconstituted as the Royal Air Force. These were the casualties of that training, and they came from all parts of the Commonwealth. This little graveyard must hold some of the very first losses from the then brand new Royal Air Force. Even the ranks, second lieutenant, are those of the superseded Royal Flying Corps, rather than of the new Royal Air Force. A gentle corner, if a shade overgrown. Usually in a place like this, the church is the most impressive building in town, but not in Stockbridge.
The imposing Grosvenor Hotel, a fine Regency building, but it's not just a hotel, it's also headquarters of the Houghton Club, Great Britain's oldest fishing club with a sought-after and restricted membership.
It was founded in 1822, and a select band of wealthy sportsmen would travel down to the Test from London and elsewhere. The Houghton was to become the mecca of fly fishing for trout. D-Day, June 44, a relatively recent entry in the club fishing book. And just 4 days after masterminding the Great Invasion, General Eisenhower came here and caught 3 trout weighing £5 each. It was the renowned Houghton waterman, William Lunn, who turned riverkeeping into the science of river management. He was succeeded as keeper by his son, and now by his grandson, the present keeper, Mick Lunn. 100 years of a family history.
Oh, this is a nice stretch of the river.
Sheepbridge Shallows by name, and quite a famous part of the Houghton Club fishing. The house you see there is where my grandfather first lived, and my father and me, both as a boy and a married man, I lived there. Mm. And that was 100 years ago now, of course.
So grandfather was presumably quite an exceptional kind of guy.
Really was. I mean, he turned out, I suppose, to be one of the finest naturalists that, this part of the country had ever known. I mean, he got all the sort of secrets, wrested the secrets from nature by fiddling with eggs from flies and all the sort of insects and the bugs that live in this river, and created sort of fly tying side of things, you know, keeping all his own chickens and plucking the feathers out of them to tie the flies. The flies we use today, you know, they're the same flies.
So he originated the science to it?
Absolutely, and this famous sort of fly called a Lunn's particular, which was the spinner of an olive, I mean, is used widely today. Yes. And always will be talked about and used, you know, it's a good fly.
So a remarkable man.
Yeah, hell of a good man. I mean, you know, I suppose father and I have lived off of his rather... lived off him a bit, but I think we've all done our part in this job, there's no doubt about it. My job today is so changed from grandfather's job, you see, really, yes. You know.
Yeah, you mentioned your job, river keeper. Well, how do you keep a river?
Well, we tend it fairly regularly, almost daily, and it's weed cutting, and it's bank trimming, tree planting, tree lopping. You've got to remember, people are coming here now to fish and they expect to see the river looking like a nice garden, and that's how we want it to be. And that's how the fish want it to be too, which is probably more important.
Oh.
And so it's all this tending. Right. And if you were just to let it go unattended, it would become a jungle and a big mess, really. You see, besides tending the rivers, we also have to tend our fishermen. In other words, we have to become gillies on occasion, taking people to the river to fish, telling them what the right sort of fly to use, and, picking out the right fish, a grayling from a trout, for instance. And also, it's interesting, too, I mean, you're complete, again, if you know the names of all the flowers that grow. And I think you should do, and all the birds that are around you.
But how much help will you give to a fisherman? I suppose you've got to be a bit careful, because they might... object to it. They might think they're a bit good.
Yeah, you're quite right there. I mean, I think what one gets to know is one's individual fisherman. For instance, I know what particular fly you like to fish with. If I suggest anything else, you'll fish it dreadfully. But if I suggest your favourite, you'll fish it beautifully. And I think you have to get to know your fisherman. You don't need to always to be a sort of dog at heel when you're out being a gilly. You're sort of standing up close, you know. I mean, you want to be going and looking around and finding a fish, making yourself useful. If he gets caught up in the tree behind and you just go and get the fly out for him, and this sort of thing.
Now, I understand that if I'd been on this bridge 100 years ago, I wouldn't see what I'm looking at now, but it would all look quite differently.
There wouldn't be any trees for a start, or very few, just the odd tree. See, in those early days, all the fishing was done with a thing called a blow line and a blow rod, which was an enormous long pole of a rod, and a light floss silk line, and on the hook you impaled the natural insect, albeit a sort of daddy long legs or a mayfly or even perhaps a grasshopper. And you'd, I mean, they slaughtered the trees on the river's bank then because they wanted to let the wind in so that you could hold the pole up and the wind took the fly onto the water, because you couldn't cast it as we do today, you see. Then, of course, eventually in the 1880s, there was suddenly the advent of the type of rod we know today, called then the whipping rod.
A rod which would bend.
Which would bend, and you could flex and fish with in this manner. And that meant one could use artificial flies, and instead of wanting the wind to do it, you could do it yourself. Oh. So immediately, what do? They all turn around and start planting the valley up the trees again, you see. And so you see today, you know, and shelter's so important, not only from the fishermen, but from the fly life itself in the river. So that when it hatches from the bed of the river, you know, it flies away into the trees, and then it... And fish farming is better, you know, we take the best from the best all the time in breeding and this sort of thing. Mm. So we're producing, I mean, the fish have jumped in weights purely because of that, really.
Right.
Better feeding, better selection.
Right, so it's again, more scientific?
More, a little bit more scientific, that's right.
Right. We'll just stroll our way along. Now, I want to ask you, because I gather that's known as the Tent Meadow. Now, why is that?
Well, you see, in the 1880s, when horse transport was the thing, I mean, members didn't have time to go back to the Grosvenor Hotel in Stockbridge to feed. So they brought the tent, pitched the tent, brought the food, the wine and the flunkies, and had it there. And didn't that saved an awful lot of time, of course.
I see. So hence the Tent Meadow.
Hence the Tent Meadow, and since 1832, I think.
And time for me to climb into my tent. Well, actually, the Grosvenor Hotel.